thank you. It's wonderful. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And that's why I'd like you to go to three people and tell them it's time for your comeback. Tell them it's time for your comeback. Tell them it's time for your comeback. Hallelujah. It's time for your comeback. It's time for.
Are not working, the power of your spirit will bring.
of Jesus. Asking that demonic yokes be broken. Asking that you will release laughter and joy into the hearts and lives of your people tonight. In the name of Jesus, anoint the lips of clay. And may I speak just what you want. In the name of Jesus, the saints will say a big amen. God richly bless you. Please resume your seat. Speaking to us tonight on the subject, I'm coming back. Hallelujah. In other words, it's time for my comeback. I'd like you to take our Bibles, people of God, to the book of Genesis chapter 37, which is our major text for this great event. Genesis chapter 37, and we want to read, take a few verses, beginning from verse 19. And verse 19 goes, here comes that dreamer. They said to each other, come now, let us kill him. Let us throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we will see what becomes of his dreams. When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. Let not take his life, he said. Don't shed any blood. Throw him into the cistern here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him. Reuben said this to rescue him from them and take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the only robe that he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into a cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. And as they sat down to eat their meal, I want you to mark this, that after throwing him in, they sat down to eat their meal. They looked up and they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Verse 26, Judah said to his brothers, what will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he's our brother, our own flesh and blood. His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants stayed by, his brothers pulled Joseph out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites who took him to Egypt. Praise the Lord. Now let's go to chapter 41. When you go to chapter 41, verse 14 to 16, it says, then Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they brought him hastily out of the dungeon, and he shaved himself and changed his raiment and came in unto Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I have dreamed a dream, and there is none that can interpret it, and I am head of a seal of thee, that thou can understand the dream and to interpret it. And Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, it is not in me. In the New International Version, Joseph actually said, I cannot. And he said, God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. The last passage I'll take is from Genesis 41. Let's take from verse 39. It says, then Pharaoh said to Joseph, inasmuch as God has shown you all this, there is no one as discerning and wise as you. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took the signet ring of his hand and put it on Joseph's hand, and he clothed him in his garments of fine linen, and put a gold chain around his neck, and had him ride in the second chariot which he had. And they cried out before him, bow down the knee. So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Somebody shout a big amen. Amen. The last passage in Proverbs 14, verse 16 to 18. For a just man falls 7 times and rises up again, but the wicked shall fall into mischief. Rejoice not when the enemy falleth, and let not thine heart be glad when he stumbles. Let the Lord see him, and it is pleasing, and he takes his wrath away from him. Praise the living God. Yesterday, we opened this conference up by establishing the indispensable role of dreams, visions, and plans in our quest to fulfill our God-given destinies. And we established the fact that it is dreamers who govern the world, it's dreamers who rule the world. Every great destiny begins with a dream. We make a statement that your future, your destiny is actually trapped in you right now. That you take a mango seed or an orange seed in the seeds that is inside of it. So whatever you can become in the future is trapped within you. Can I hear somebody say a big amen? We noted again that if you can dream big enough, God is going to take you very far. Dreams give you direction. Dreams give you the opportunity to break frontiers, to do new things, to do what was previously unimagined and what was deemed by other people as not possible. God wants every one of his people to be dreamers. Every single great man in scripture that God called and God wanted to give them a future, he began with a dream. When he called Jeremiah, he began with a dream. When he called Abraham, he took him outside. He said, Abraham, count all the stars. If you can count all of these stars, he says, as much as you can count, I'm going to give it to you. That was the dream, the picture. And we said, it is a sneak peek of what the future or the entire summary of what God has for you is going to look like. Somebody made a statement one time and he said, some people have been humorously called NFA. Somebody say NFA. NFA means no future ambition. If you're a young lady and you're looking for a guy to marry, don't go for an NFA. Go for somebody who has an ambition for great things. Somebody say, I am not an NFA. Hallelujah. I also want to make a point tonight that, you know, if you would have a vision and you would have a dream, it is important to ensure that you are not imitating other people. That is something really, really important. Today, we have too many imitators in the world. You know, God wants you not to die as a photocopy of another person's life, because he has a life that is set out for you. He has a race that is cut out for you. We are not competing among ourselves. When you compete with your own self and you break your own boundaries and the records you set for yourself yesterday, you overcome them today. Hallelujah. You know, God doesn't want imitators because imitation is a limitation. Tell somebody, imitation is a limitation. Because when you imitate somebody, you are limiting yourself to the person's destiny. Meanwhile, God might have something bigger in store for you. Bible says, I am not seen, neither has ears heard the things that God has destined for them that love him. Can I get a witness in the house? The comeback of the dreamer. I want to make a couple of points. Number one, dreams can be silenced, they can be killed, or they can be stolen. They can be silenced, they can be killed, they can be stolen. Some instances, you will see strange things happen to people that rips them of their future ambitions and their future plans. Like one time, I had the story of this young girl, about 7-year-old girl in elementary school who was singing a song to the school. And while she was singing, and the person who told me was there, she was singing and suddenly her mouth twisted, and then before they realized, stroke had taken a hold on a 7-year-old, ripping apart her destiny, and giving her a very difficult future because of that attack that happened. So there are certain things that can happen that have the potential of stealing, diverting, or destroying people's dreams. There are other things that can destroy people's dreams, and it includes things like parental and societal rejection. There are young people today who their parents are rejecting them. Their parents are mistreating them. They are going through abuse. They go through trauma. They go through so much that what God wants them to become, it gets twisted because their very nature and identity has been affected and battered by that painful experience that they are going through. Can I? Are you hearing what I'm saying? So you see, those are the kinds of things that it takes the Spirit of God to heal. There was a time that I ministered in I happened to be the national pencil leader and youth leader for the Church of Pentecost USA nationwide. And our last pencil conference, I ministered one of the evenings, I believe Friday evening or so, and I ministered on overcoming an identity crisis that our young people in this country are struggling with. And as I talked about abuse and all the kinds of trauma that young people go through, in fact, the Spirit of God is so resonated with some of the young college students who were gathered. By the time I finished, this young lady was rushing to the front, just fell down there, crying out her heart unto the Lord, and the mighty hand of God came upon her and delivered her mightily. Later, the mother came and narrated the ordeal of laziness and lack of passion can be one of the things that can kill your dream. You also see, no lazy man ever becomes great. You must be a hardworking person. No lazy person. You are a student here, young person listening to me, and you sleep all day, sleep all night, and you expect to pass your examinations. You can't pass your examinations and get to your destiny by sleeping. Wake up, get out of the comforter and study, and go pass that exam with flying colors. We need students in the house of God who be air students, who are fly, high flyers among their colleagues, who are the head and never the tail, who will not settle even for an A minus. Pray for the ears. I took some class in graduate school, and when the semester was getting over, I realized I was getting an A minus in it, and I was going because it was a very difficult course. And the professor said, if you guys, anybody who wants to take, do something to make your grades better, you can realize that I'm prepared to go and do something to get. And one of the ladies in the class saw me and said, I'm not going to go through anything. You A minus and you are still worrying yourself. I said, I'm not settling. If there's something better than A minus, I'm going for that. I am going for that. Hallelujah. Don't settle for less. Hallelujah. Don't settle for less. Crippling effect of fear, satanic attacks. These things are things that can affect people's dreams. Number two, dreams take time to come to pass. Joseph had to wait 13 years. David waited 15 years to become the king. So dreams take time. And sometimes that is a struggle people have. People cannot wait for God's timing. They want to rush and leave the place that God has positioned them to have their dreams manifested. People are too much in a hurry and are looking for quick fixes. Or this secrecy, not to be discovered. Now, but some of us we go chasing for it. And you are going, the Holy Ghost is telling you, don't go, you are still going. Don't go, don't make that phone call. You are hearing the voice, don't make that phone call. That phone call will divert your entire destiny. The Lord deliver us from dangerous phone calls. Hallelujah. Prayer has been the point at which dreams are born, and power to guide those dreams to fruition is released. Prayer. You see, the secret of all failure is our failure in a secret place. The secret of all failure is our failure to stay in the secret place of prayer and wait on God. Prayer is the key to turning the tide around in your situation. Prayerless Christians cannot experience heavenly push in their lives. If you want to become a voice in society for people to hear you, you must be able to first be a voice before heaven. For heaven to hear you, you see, you must be able to receive from God before people will gravitate in your direction. And all of that happens through prayer. Somebody say prayer. Jabez realized that his life was falling apart. He said, oh God, enlarge my territory and take away pain and harm from me and bless my life. The Bible says, God granted him his request. Tonight, pray. I said, tonight, pray. Tonight, pray. Prayer will turn the tide around in your favor. Some woman, I heard this testimony of this woman who took the daughter who suddenly went blind into to see a minister for them to pray for. And the minister took them and put them in the room and said, and sensed that something is not right. So he put them in the room and he said, pray that every force of darkness that is responsible for this blindness must be removed. So go pray. The Lord put them in. And they were praying. The master was hearing them praying. And after some time, they were not hearing the woman. They were hearing only the young girl. And when they went and opened the door, the woman had gone blind. And the girl's eyes had opened. Some backfiring has happened over there. May some backfiring happen in your life. But pray for the welfare of people. Hallelujah. So, number two, the favor of God is one thing that can cause you to be accelerated or move forward in your dream. Bible says that God gave Joseph favor. If you read the scriptures over and over and over again, it kept repeating that Joseph found favor in the eyes of Potiphar. And because of that, he said, Potiphar saw that God was with him. And whatever he did prospered. And so he put him in charge. Favor continually put Joseph in charge. The favor of God can put you in charge. Favor will take you from zero to hero. Favor will take you from places where you are undeserving to a place where people will look at you and will say, you don't belong to that office. We are surprised you are there. May favor locate you today. You will never realize your dreams in life by hard work alone. It will take many master strokes of favor being extended towards you at several milestones in your life. Somebody said a day of favor is more than many years of labor. You do not have to be favored by everyone in order to get your break in life. You just need that one person that God will position in your life and grant you favor before that person. And before you realize, you are flying to the next level. May God begin to bring people who will grant you favor. I said people who will cause you to move to the next level. I shared this testimony in our church that some time ago, when I left a graduate school and then I was searching for a job, they advertised this position and they said, it's a position to work in the city. And I work with infant mortality and monitor things that provide community-wide education. I've gotten a degree in public health, but I hadn't gotten the management experience that is needed for that position because they advertised a 5-year experience in director level. And so I looked at it and said, no, this one. I don't think I need to apply for this. You can't even apply for this type of job. But I said, go and try. You don't know what God can do. Let's pray. It's good to have a good wife for you. Go and try. I said, I'm going. All right. So Peter, my husband, everything. Then I went there. When I went there, the woman, they interviewed me and everything. They said, submit your, other credentials, whatever. I don't have much. Sometimes when you don't have much, God has his own to win. Praise the Lord. So I added a little bit, just give them what they wanted. And then they called all the references. When they called the references, the lady that I did internship with in Boston actually told them that, yes, I'm a good guy, but if she doesn't think I have the management experience to handle that position. Once your reference has disqualified you, it is over. But if God says it is not over, it is not over. So I went there, and then the CEO was interviewing me, and he said, well, your reference told me this, and I can see that you don't have the required managerial experience for this position. And then she paused a bit and said, but I will help you. I will help you. I will help you. Hallelujah. She granted me the job, took me to this office, showed me so many people. You are going to be supervising these people. Here is your office, this and that. And I'm like, is that me? Hallelujah. When God turned again the captivity of Zion, then were we like them that dream. And we serve the Lord as that great day whereof we are glad. May the Lord do great things for you tonight. I said, may the Lord do great things for you tonight. That person that is carrying your destiny in his pocket, may the fire of heaven move in your direction. May the rain of the Holy Ghost locate him from wherever and bring him into your way and give you a break in life. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let this CEO now will get TV interview opportunities, and then you'll call my phone or ring and say, I needed to go on this television station and speak about this subject.
Hey.
So now I was in her state. Junior CEO. Hallelujah. And people of God, God makes things so beautiful. First year on the job, when I was still finding my grounds, when the company executives met, they reviewed all the workers in this company, and they said, this guy is the employee of the year. Ah, yes. 1 year on the job, he is the employee of the year. Because, you know, they will send me to Washington, D.C. and all.